Hey everyone, welcome back. So I released a video last week about coding boot camps and whether or not they're still worth it. And somebody commented on the video and basically said, hey, don't go to a boot camp. You can learn all this stuff for free online. The question of that video wasn't really, can you learn all this stuff for free online? But the comment did make me start to think a little bit about how I would recommend somebody learn on their own for free online if I were to give advice on that. So today I wanted to talk about how I would learn to code, knowing what I know. If I had to start from scratch and do it for free, this is what I would do. Now, just a quick aside, I didn't address in that video, and I'm not addressing here, whether or not you should go to a boot camp or try to learn on your own for free. I think it depends a lot on your personal scenarios, financially and otherwise. And so I'm not really going to touch that question, but I'm just going to address, if I were to do this, this is how I would do it. So let's go ahead and get into it. Okay, so I've got kind of five stages here. And for each stage, there's a resource that you can use to help you accomplish the goals of that stage. Now, some of this stuff I've mentioned before, so if you've seen my prior videos, then you may just want to skip ahead a little bit. I will include markers in the description below, so you can just go ahead and skip to wherever is most relevant for you. Okay, without further ado, let's go ahead and get into it. So, stage one of learning to code for free online is to find a resource. Now, the number one resource that I recommend for people who are learning to code or even just want to try coding is Free Code Camp. Now, there's a lot of great things about Free Code Camp. Like the name says, it's entirely free. But in addition to that, what I really like about Free Code Camp is it has a very structured curriculum wherein each lesson builds on things that you've already learned. Half the battle when learning to code, and especially when you're on your own, is just figuring out where to start and what the things are that you need to learn. And Free Code Camp totally takes that work off your plate and allows you to just focus on learning the skills and not having to figure out what it is that you should be learning in the first place. With that said, there's other resources out there. There's the Odin Project, there's Treehouse, but like I said, my number one pick is Free Code Camp. So if you're looking for a resource to get started, I think that will be a great one. Okay, so that's stage one. Stage two, you can do concurrently with stage one. And in fact, I would recommend you do them at the same time, and that is build projects. So the good thing about Free Code Camp is there are projects baked into the curriculum that you have to do in order to get the certification, but there are plenty of other places you can find project ideas. One of my favorite sources for project is called Frontend Mentor. And the cool thing about Frontend Mentor is you're basically working as you would if you were in an agency, for example, as a front-end developer. So basically the idea is that you get a Photoshop mockup and it's your job to implement that on a pixel perfect basis. So that's kind of how things would work if you were coding in real life, like on a team or in a company. And so I think that's super valuable and helps you get a feel for what it's like to build real world projects. There are a lot of other places you can find project ideas. There's tons of repos on GitHub, and I'll go ahead and include one in the description below that I really like that has like 12 or 14 pretty interesting project ideas that range from easy to hard. But the point is you want to be building projects at the same time as you're learning skills, because it helps you reinforce what you're learning, and it also helps you to build out a portfolio of projects, which will be important when you come to the whole job hunting phase. All right, let's talk about stage three, which is find a mentor. So it's inevitable that you will get stuck when you're learning to code. Everybody goes through it. I still go through it now. It's just kind of part of the craft. And that can be really frustrating, especially when you don't know where to turn. And so that's where finding a mentor is going to come in. A mentor can help you on a very practical level get unstuck from whatever's blocking you. But a mentor can also provide advice and direction and ideas on how best to approach problems or best practices. It is invaluable learning from other people that are more experienced than you are. And so I highly recommend that you find a mentor. There are plenty of places to find a mentor. So if you want to go the free route, you can use Free Code Camp. They also have a community, and I'm guessing there's at least a few people in there that would be willing to mentor somebody that's completely new to programming. But if you might feel guilty about taking up someone's time, you can go for a paid resource. I've mentioned a couple of these before. So the first one is Mentor Cruise. And this is basically like an Airbnb for a code mentor, someone that can help you get unstuck, like I said, and just give you advice. And you kind of pay them by the hour usually. And so it's kind of like you're just hiring somebody like on Fiverr or any of those services, but it's specific to programming. Another service like this is called codementor.io. And the idea is very similar. So I would look there if you want maybe a dedicated mentor, someone that has a particular specialty, or if you just would rather pay somebody than not. All right, stage four is network. I mentioned before, I don't like the phrase networking, but I won't go into that now. The point is you want to build a community around yourself of like-minded people that you can learn from, that can maybe help you if you need it. And I would recommend doing that both virtually and locally. So virtually, I'd recommend Twitter. Twitter is, for better or worse, where tech people tend to hang out and have conversations. I'm beginning to really like Twitter. I didn't really get it for a long time, but it's great. And so what I would do is follow a bunch of people that use the kind of technology that you're interested in. So let's say React.js, if you want to learn React, I would follow Kent C. Dodds and Wes Boss and Scott Zielinski and Dan Abramov. And then figure out who's interacting with them in their tweets and replies and follow those people. And before long, you'll have a feed of people that are doing React professionally and most likely pushing the library forward and coming up with new innovations. And you'll just learn a lot from them. And I would chime in, ask questions, try and be helpful where you can. And before long, you'll build up a community around yourself online. I would do the same thing in your city with Meetup, assuming that there are developer meetups in town. If there aren't many to choose from, then I would just go to the ones that you have available to you. But if they tend to be specific to a particular language or framework or environment, I would try and pick the one that is relevant to the technology that you're interested in and do the same thing. Go there, try to be helpful, talk to people, ask them about themselves and the work they're doing. Before long, you'll have a local community around you as well. And who knows, you may even find a mentor there. Regardless, this step is pretty crucial, I think. And a lot of people skip over it and just try to do their best when it comes to the next step, which is job searching. But if you can really focus here, I think the next step and the rest of your career will be a lot easier, hopefully. And last but not least comes applying for jobs. So I mentioned before in my video about how I got a job after coding bootcamp that basically a mistake I made was to do a spray and pray approach where I just sent out indiscriminately a bunch of job applications, didn't even really try to figure out who worked at the companies, didn't really care a lot of times about the company as long as it looked cool. And that is basically a bad strategy. So what I recommend people do here is to make a short list of the companies that you're interested in, or maybe start by city if you're gonna start in the city you're in. Start by city and then filter down to a select list of companies within your city, and then try and figure out who the decision makers are. LinkedIn is gonna be really critical for this, but I would use LinkedIn to figure out who the engineering manager is or who the VP of engineering is. Somebody like that that is ultimately going to be responsible for hiring you or not hiring you. And I would reach out and just say, hey, I'm interested in your company. Can we get coffee? Or, hey, I'm going to apply. Please look out for my application and then follow up when you do apply. Even doing small things like this is going to make a really big difference when it comes to your success rate for your job applications. Now, if you did step four well, then you might even know a few people on the inside of the company that you could also reach out to after you apply, who could hopefully put a good word in for you. So that's why it's important to kind of do that networking phase, for lack of a better term. But regardless, the point is that you want to give yourself the best chance possible of success. And the way that that is done, in my opinion, is to be very selective and focused with your energy as you're applying for jobs. So that's it. That's how I would teach myself to code and get a job if I had to start from scratch today, knowing everything that I know. I hope you found this helpful if you're considering going the self-taught route. If you're still here, you'd probably like the rest of my channel, which focuses on software engineering and career development. Regardless, thanks so much for watching to the end. Remember, stay hungry, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.